to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're back, the final road trip of the season, of season six. An amazing season, a really fun one. We're doing, well, this, I think, is road trip number eight. So it wasn't as road trip heavy as I initially thought it was going to be. But nonetheless, it's still been a really great season, I think, personally. Might not think so, but I certainly do. We're on the road back to Aberdeen. We're going to the Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen today for a WrestleZone Granite City Showdown. So this is a bit touch and go whether it was going to happen, whether the show was going to be, or whether I was going to make it to the show, more accurately, because last couple of days it's been snowing, and really snowy. So there was a good chance that I wasn't going to make it because of the weather. And then everyone kind of came down with a sickness in my house as well, so we had to to see how that was going to go. So it's been a very interesting couple of days in the old SWN towers. But we're here. We're on our road. We're on the way to WrestleZone Granite City Showdown, and it's got an absolute stacked lineup that I cannot wait to see to go through. So I will try and go through it in a moment. My wipers are working this time. That was better than the last time I did the road trip. So the first thing I'm doing, as boring as it sounds, I'm going to go drop off the dog to my parents. So drop her off, and then she's going to be there until Monday. And then I go pick her up on Monday when I go drop off my son for daycare. So it works out fine. I'm very weird. I can barely see any of these sunglasses at the moment because they're just steamed up because of hot stuff. But we'll persevere. We're alright, I think. So, yeah, Granite City Showdown. Last one of the season. I think this is the penultimate episode of the actual season. We've got two episodes to come afterwards. But the finale, of course, I've already mentioned that. I haven't mentioned that, but the finale will be the year-end awards, which are all written up. Graphics are all made for it as of time of recording. I just need to record it, which will be a Monday job. So I'll record that, edit it together, put the bells and whistles on it, and then it'll go on Patreon as soon as I've done it, pretty much. And then what will happen is it'll go live on the 31st. That's the plan anyway. So that's the last episode. And then we're going to do an encore. Well, no, actually, no, we're doing an epilogue first. I don't know if I'm using the word epilogue correctly, but we're doing an epilogue scheduled to be with Frank Gallo. Now, I know what you're thinking, but Billy, you've sold a t-shirt saying six seasons in a t-shirt. That's why I've called it an epilogue, so it's not technically part of the season. It's just after the season. You know, I've kind of fudged my way out of that one. And then the last episode of the season, they will take a month off doing SWN podcasts. Well, releasing SWN podcasts, because I'll be recording them, so I've got them batched ready, will be with Mickey Vago as the encore. And that's what I'm recording first. So recording that one on Tuesday, and then recording the epilogue on Saturday, a couple hours before Royal Rumble. Stay up for Royal Rumble, of course, because that's the one you stay up for each year. And then you end up saying that you're not going to stay up for WrestleMania, and then you end up staying up for WrestleMania. That's just how it works. As it does for me every year when I don't take the time off, because I go, I'm going to stay up for WrestleMania this year. And I inevitably do. But the show itself, Granite City Showdown, as I said, Richard Energy Arena in Aberdeen. I'm going to go find it today. There was some directions put up on the WrestleZone Facebook page, Twitter, Instagram, what have you. So I know where to put in to the old Google Maps to find it. So usually I would go there, I'd find the venue, and I work my way back to find somewhere to eat, and then go to the show. That's going to be my plan, as it usually is, and I'll work out that way. But a bigger venue, tickets are still available at the door, which, thank goodness, because of the weather, I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to go, so I didn't buy a ticket initially. I was kind of waiting to see how the weather was going to go, so I'm going to get a ticket when I'm there. VIP, of course, I'm going to get that extra match in, because it's a cracking extra match. I'm looking forward to seeing it. So we'll do a little bit of a preview, I suppose, of the show. as I rabble my way all the way to Bucky. Just trying to remember if I've actually remembered everything to take. I think I have, so hope for the best. So, pre-show. I've said so many times already. Pre-show, it is Damien and William Sterling reunited, and it feels so good, taking on the team of Restalkins and Brian Tucker. I really enjoyed the little setup for this. Restalkins just confronting William Sterling while he was fixing the ring. Gave him a 10-second countdown to find a tag team partner, or he was going to face Dawkins and Tucker in a handicap match. And then Damien was just happened to be under the ring doing some repairs as well, and we got that match. Do I have to see Damien in a VIP match? I haven't checked, but I don't think he's been in one. Yeah, he's been in the VIP match. He's always been main show or what have you. He's not actually been in a VIP match. I could be wrong. I'm not a walking encyclopedia, but I think that's the case. So we're going to see Dawkins and Tucker against Sterling and Damien, which will be a lot of fun. Haven't seen William Sterling for Saudi Anarchy. That's the rest of the match instead. So hopefully better luck this time when it comes to possibly doing some elbow drops and what have you. See how that goes. And then move on to the main card. I'm just rattling through the preview today. Rattling through the main card. Start off with the triple threat. So we've got Zach Dynamite taking on Ollie Green and Tommy Raiden in a triple threat match, which should be a lot of fun. When I saw this match was announced, I was like, well, if you guys are here, if Ollie and Tommy are here, who's on the pre-show? That's very different, very strange. But we're going to get to see them on the main show. This is the first time Ollie Green outside of Regal Rumble, him being on the main card, which will be good. I really enjoy Ollie Green. I think he's really good, a good wrestler, a good prospect for the future as well. So it's good to see him progress to the main card for the first show in 2024. I'd love to be doing this drive faster, but I'm stuck behind someone who's going at 25 miles per hour. This is a piss take. Come on. Anywho, the snow's gone. Anyway, so we've got Zach Dynamite in there, who's coming off a loss to Dino in Christmas Chaos. Didn't have a great back end of the year when it came to the outfit, so he's got a little bit of a chip on his shoulder there to try and maybe just bully some young boys about. And then we've got Tommy Raiden, who's now the ward of Mickey Vago, and he got himself in a little bit of a scrape with Judas Grey at Christmas Chaos. So we'll see if there's any more underhanded and sneaky tactics coming from Tommy Raiden. I'm keeping my eye on him. Keep my eye on that progress there. But no, it should be a nice little triple threat match. We'll see, just to see how Dynamite combats it, and how these, especially for Ollie, how he copes with being on a main show. I mean, I think I may have said in my preview, that, like the WrestleZone podcast preview, that there's not that big of a difference between the VIP crowd and the main show crowd, because there are maybe only like 5 people pay a general admission ticket, the rest of them pay for that extra match. So the crowd itself probably isn't going to be that much different. I mean, it's a bigger venue, so the opportunity there is going to be a bigger crowd, full stop. But that would have been the case if it was the VIP section or not. But the fact that he's progressed from the VIP bit to a main show, it just speaks to how well he's progressed over the year. So it's more of a, it's less of a wrestling in front of more people. It's more a case of he's went up the ranks now into the main portion of the card, and he's done the pre-show, so to speak. So yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing how that match is going to go. What else we got? So we've got Omar Mohamed versus Captain Alan Sterling. Very interesting prospect of a match. I think the last time they faced off, it may have been in Ellen. It might have been Ellen last year. I didn't go to that show, so I'm thinking it might have been Ellen last year. So Omar, he got a little bit of a knock in Christmas Chaos. He wasn't there to see Mr. WrestleZone get absolutely pummeled by the Foundation of the Future. Comes in a little bit annoyed, a little bit angry. Comes in against Captain Allen, who is just Captain Allen Starling, who is just a bit nuts. So I don't know how he's going to cope. I don't know. Captain Allen Starling is one of those enigmas where you go, you don't know how to kind of react to Captain Allen Starling. You don't know whether he's all there, whether he understands anything particularly. He's a bit conniving, he's a bit madcap at the same time. He's an interesting beast when it comes to WrestleZone as Captain Allen Starling. So we'll see how that kind of clashes. It's a match I haven't seen yet. I'm interested to see how it goes though, because I like the shenanigans of Captain Allen. I really enjoy watching Omar again. I haven't seen him progress in the last few years. He's certainly become more sensational as the time has went along, and he's selling merch. He's got merch on this show as well, so he's going to be a little bit, maybe a bit more flashy to try and convince some people to part with their hard-earned bucks. I'm assuming it'll be 20 quid. That seems to be the norm for wrestling t-shirts nowadays. He'll be looking to get a couple of pennies in the pocket. And a flashy show-off match against Captain Allen Starling will certainly do that. Like I said, Captain Allen, well, he came off the loss in Christmas Chaos to Damien, but he had a really good 2023 by all accounts. He had a very good win-loss record as well, so it'll be interesting to see if he maintains that in 2024 or if that loss in the Christmas Chaos has knocked it a bit and the boat has been rocked, so to speak, and he tries to recapture those winning ways by any means necessary. So I don't know whether he's going to have C-Santa on board. It is January, so probably not. Whether he's going to find some other weird valet, weird valet manager. Maybe he can find Jeeves. Maybe Jeeves will be somewhere. So we've also got Evan Young returns. Evan Young's back. He first match since Ambriarchy as well. He returned against Captain Allen Starling and then kind of disappeared from that point onwards. Mr. 2004 himself. I am going to overtake this slow bastard. So he's back. He takes on Chris Archer, a wrestler who's, again, back on the main shows. He was on pre-shows for the last couple of shows he's been on after Ariarki, opened Ariarki, and then he kind of disappeared for a bit. So we don't know, we still don't really know what caused Chris Archer to do what he did to Mickey Vago. As far as I can remember, anyway, and I keep saying this, nobody's corrected me yet, so I don't know if I missed something somewhere. So we still don't know what caused Archer to turn on Vago and turn against the fans and all that kind of stuff. So he's coming up against Evan Young. These two guys, a bit shorter in stature, but I've always said, because Archer, you always get a solid match out of him at the bare minimum. The very least you get is a solid match from Chris Archer. And Evan, a lot of heart, a lot of spirit. Pardon me, that was disgusting. A lot of heart, a lot of spirit. I'm looking forward to seeing how he comes back and see if he's pretty much said in one of his promo video for this match that 2024 is probably the most important year in his wrestling career. We don't know whether it means that if one more injury occurs, that could be him reevaluating what he is doing, whether wrestling is the path for him, and in a wrestling standpoint, maybe a loss will make him reevaluate what he's doing and how wrestling is to him as a career option, as a path for him. So a lot is at stake for Evan Young, whereas Chris Archer, I think he's still chasing a win. I can't remember the last time he won a match in WrestleZone. What was it? Training Academy. That was April last year, something like that. I think he beat Ollie Green. So I think that's the last time we saw Chris Archer pick up a win. So that's a long time. It's coming up to, what's that? Nine months, something like that. I should have a child in that time. So it's been a while since he's had a win in WrestleZone, so he'll be looking to try and right that wrong as well and try and get a win into his with a lost record, start of the year, start his cap, paid off with a win. I've said win too many times, apologise. So, what else have we got then? Tag title match will go then. Foundation of the Future, they are chasing back the titles, they're going to try and regain the titles from the Outfit. Ted O'Keefe and Murphy, they won the titles at Christmas Chaos in that big four-way tag team match. They pinned Bruiser Brad as well. So again, Brad and Ryan will have another. There's a lot of chips on their shoulders on this show. Again, there's a lot about picking up momentum back, not only for winning titles and the likes, but also for momentum into the Regal Rumble, which will be March 30th. So there's a lot at stake in this particular show. It's momentum. It's possibly title aspirations. There's a lot going on that we could possibly see develop on this show. So a lot to happen. I don't know how it's going to go. The Foundation really haven't been able to figure out the outfit. The outfit have had a pretty good time of it against the Foundation of the Future recently. Whether it's singles matches or tag team six-man tags, they've seemed to have got the Foundation's number. So I'll be interested to see if the outfit can do it once again, and they can once again knock off Foundation of the Future to kick off the year. That'll be it's a big sculpt, because Foundation are probably one of the best teams in the country. Like, I think that's without a doubt. So for the outfit to possibly extend their win-loss streak against the Foundation is pretty big for them to establish themselves as worthy tag team champions. So we'll get to see how that comes along. What else have we got then? I'm trying to remember. Mickey Vigo's in the match. He's got Luke King Sharp's making his return. First match since, I think, Abby Anarchy 2022. The tag team match. It was Sammy Kreiger versus Mr. P and Sean Johnson. So the first time we're seeing them two, seeing Luke King Sharp back. Since then, I think that was the last time we saw him. So we've got that, which should be a lot of fun. We've got a little bit of history, backstory. Both of them were in the same match when they defeated Devon Dudley. So we've got that, with a little bit of history involved. I really hope we see Blood Tourist looking sharp, because I've seen a bit of him, as Blood Tourist when he's been doing W3L shows. And he's just, it's just like this kind of gremlin scrap character that he's got going, that he's just takes it to the crowd, just brawls, and nothing fancy about it. I think that's a game that Vigo can go into quite competently as well. So we're going to see. I think that's just going to be a good old fashioned like brawl. I'm interested to see if Tommy Raider plays a factor. I'm also interested to see if, I mean, it's not been announced for the show, but I'd be interested to see if, like, Judas Grey maybe pops back for some revenge. Because of Tommy Raider. I mean, I'm not saying that the match was a foregone conclusion if Judas would have won, but I'm saying that because of Tommy Raider, Judas lost. So I'm interested to see if we maybe see some further developments to that. I've used developments quite a lot in this episode as well already in the first 15 minutes. So I apologise for my repeating this and that repetition. And all of that, now we've got the main event. I think I've remembered everything. Main event being Caleb Valhalla and Lost Boy Aspen, Skull Brawl, taking on Flippy and Drippy, Ronan King and Connor Malloy, tag team match. I'm buzzing for this one. I think it's going to be an absolute riot. I think it's going to be a lot of fun to watch as a spectator. Ronan and Connor are probably going to be chopped into oblivion, but I think they're going to give as good as they get as well. I think this is your potential looking at maybe even not your final four, because Aspen is the champion, but possibly looking at in your final three in the Regal Rumble as well. So I think we're going to get a little bit of a preview of the Regal Rumble from this particular match also. Flippy and Drippy, they're just out there. We've seen Connor join Ronan King in WrestleZone officially. at Christmas Chaos after the match, after Asuka was able to retain against Conor Malloy. So we got to see them finally joined up. They've tagged a couple, I think Community Pro is their place they tagged. So now we get to see Flippy and Trippy properly in Aberdeen as a tag team. And Kelly is raging that she's not getting to see this. She's currently ill. So I've left her alone with Jack for the day, for the afternoon. So she's furious, but she'll hopefully be back for the Regal Rumble. And she'll get to see a Rumble, because she loves a Rumble. Rumble's the best. Rumbles are always the best. So yeah, I can't wait. It's going to be fun. I've got no predictions for anything on the show, because I don't know anything. I think I'm possibly maybe coming down with something too. I'm alright, I tested negative. I haven't got COVID, but I possibly have rattled a wee bit of a cold. So I will probably be avoiding people. I've got a couple things I want to do, and drop off some things to people at the show. But generally, I'm probably going to avoid things like photos. I mean, you'll probably see the montage, and I haven't, but loads of photos if I feel well enough for it. But generally, if I feel flu-y, it might just be a little bit of a chill. I don't know. I'm rambling now. Anyway, so I think that's me checked out the whole preview of the show. I'm looking forward to it. I need to go find the venue, the Rich Energy Arena. Apparently I'm looking for Karuna Road, Aberdeen Gymnastics something centre. I don't know. I'll find it. I'll go Google Maps. It's all good. In the meantime, then, that's me just about bucket to go drop off Santa Claus to my parents for the weekend. So you can go play with my parents' dog, Hogan. And I'm going to go to Aberdeen. I'm apprehensive, because it's a new venue, I need to go find it, but I can't wait for the show in general. It's Granite City Showdown, starting the year off strong with a big arena. I'm hoping that there's a big enough crowd to maybe necessitate being an Aberdeen Anarchy venue or something. That would be really cool. So I know that Regal Rumble's going to be a curl as well, but I'm hoping a good turnout tonight at the Rich Energy Arena. Really hope so. So next thing you'll probably see will be the little video that I do to show around the venue, and then the montage. So that's it. Granite City Showdown. Let's go do it.
Taking off, find a place with a view. The pain is never gonna stop if it's controlling you. I know the time can heal. through this. Life is a nuisance, tie up some loose ends. I try to be human, find a solution, my evolution. A place like this, it didn't exist, we made it like this. So you can go pick the bad or the good, got a glass halfway. I know, it's easier to hide than just to lay low. Not everyone in life has got a halo. I'm standing in the red inside a payphone. Just wanna break, no. I'm not gonna give in, take a last shot, Michael J. Win. No, I'm not a robot, I'm in my own skin. Never get lost when thoughts pull you in. I miss the old you, we died with a purpose. All the energy around me felt nervous. Scared I would pop out fast to the surface. Had to cut it off before you made me worthless. Torn apart, I've been torn and scarred. I had a given heart, but now I'm thinking smart. I'm keeping up my guard, I'm hiding every card. I'm more flush, I'm left, you never know when. Start with a back to the mat, gonna see where I'm at. I'ma fight like I'm mad, I'm a beast, something that they can never be me. Nice try, but they'll see I achieve everything. Wanna stay salty. They do, and now I feel like taking off. Find a perfect view. The pain is never gonna stop. If I'm controlling you, I know the time can heal it all. I just gotta get through. I just gotta get through. I just gotta get through. Cause I feel like taking off. Find a place with a view. The pain is never gonna stop. If it's controlling you, I know the time can heal it all. I just gotta get through. I just gotta get through.
Hello, it's Darkness here. It's Billy here. Granite City Showdown, WrestleZone, post-show thoughts, feelings, emotions, everything in between. And weird Darkness. I don't know if I'll be able to. I might just, like, if you're seeing something different, video watchers, I may have put, like, a text or something in place. Because I know that it's very dark. I am here, though. I don't know. I might do some text. Anyway, yes, I'm on my way home. The time is now 10:30. I got sent through Old Belgium again by my bloody Google Maps, even though I thought I avoided it. It's just a wee arse of a town. It's just a wiggly waggly town to get through. But I'm on my way home. I'm going to turn off past somewhere on my way to the signage for Inverness. It's always a good sign. But yeah, what a show from WrestleZone tonight. So it would take place at, as I've already mentioned in the preview bit, taking place at a new venue, that being Rich Energy Arena. And when you went in, they kind of cordoned off half of the venue, and it was certainly a walk-up sellout. I think Sean Rankin, who you may see on Twitter or X, put up like landscape photos, panoramic pictures of shows he goes to. I think he has thought it was a walk-in sellout. I agree with that as well, as they were putting out extra chairs and making sure that people were getting in, and it was quite a close, compact event in the Rich Energy Arena. Walk-up sellout, but I think if they are going to use that venue again for an Anarchy, they could easily probably push the stage, the curtain back further, and they can get more people in and make a proper big full place. That could be an Anarchy arena easily, maybe even a Regal Rumble eventually as well, and making like a leisure centre / ballroom kind of venue for WrestleZone, which would be good. Parking was a bit of a nightmare. It wasn't that great, to be honest. But getting there, other than sat-nav, Google Maps, whatever, taking me around the houses to actually get to the venue, it was relatively easy to get to. There was a KFC nearby. That was where I went for my tea. There's a Lidl nearby as well, so I got a Monster. I was able to kind of push on through. It's just been one of those weeks where I'm just tired. And that's why I've got this little cough as well. Which I was feeling, I was getting annoyed with during the show. Just a little cough every so often, like when I'm biting it down. So that was irritating for me. Don't know if it was irritating for anyone else sitting next to me, but it was certainly irritating for me. But the show itself, man, the pre-show, Damien and William Sterling defeated Dawkins and Tucker. Pure panto. You know, it was silly bollocks. It was great, though. It was just a little bit of fun that you can't really not smile at, you know. It was just really, it was just good clean fun. A bit of silliness with atomic drops and what have you, and it was just a really entertaining match to kick off the show on a really high note. VIP still in name only, because I think after the general opened, I think it's the most I've seen people come in for the general ticket. Again, I think that's because it was a walk-up for a lot of people because of the weather, and being January as well. The pennies are a little bit more pinched right about that time, this time of year. So there were more seats getting piled in into areas. And I think that kind of affected a little bit of like their they've got a banner, the WrestleZone banner, where they get photos with the wrestlers at interval. I think that caused a little bit of issues with them adding more seats in. That became a bit more squished, so it couldn't really. It was getting pictures with the wrestlers and getting with that, it was a little bit more difficult. I got a picture of the outfit, because why not? Why not? Me and Ted have got a little bit of history, so it was nice to get a picture with Ted. And he mugged me during said picture, but like I said, water under the bridge, I think, for me and Ted, possibly. I don't know. I think it's one of those things where it can flare up at any minute, kind of things. But yeah, the pre-show, just good fun. Just like Rhys Dawkins, I don't know. I doubt my 24 will be out by the time this comes out, because I'm just so slow to do that at the moment. Rhys Dawkins is one of my guys to watch this year. He really is. I think he is super entertaining. He's got a really good character. He's got a strong character. There's just the silliness works in his favour. And I think he's a really competent wrestler as well. Him and Brian have a really good dynamic. It's just a lot of good stuff coming from Rhys Dawkins. And I think having him in with Damien again really showed that how confident he is becoming from the wrestling standpoint, where he's already got the confidence with the character standpoint of the Shakespearean smartest wrestler on the side of the globe. You know, all that kind of stuff. He's got that down to a T. It's just getting the wrestling. It is getting up to par as well, along with the strongness of the character. So, great. I really enjoy Rhys Dawkins. Great to see Damien again. Really quite easy night for Damien. He's doing the majority of the work for his team. Without William Starling as well, kind of did the whole bowing after the match. Seems like possibly every match is a bonus for William Starling, it seems, right now. And we'll get into that a little bit later on. But I'm just remembering things as I go along, so I'm trying to remember the lineup of the card. You'll see with the montage what the lineup of the card was. I got a lot of videos this time, so it might just be like a lot of videos and then like a top and tail with the entrances and the winners. I don't know, I haven't really decided at that point. It's now like 20 to 11. I haven't really got that far thinking of how I'm doing the episode, even though I'm croaky with buggery. Sorry about that. So I kicked off the show with Luke Sharp and Mickey Vago. Vago came out on his own, no Tommy Raiden with him, and this was just, oh man, I loved a little bit of backstory, a little bit of history here. Luke Sharp coming out shouting that he beat Devon Dudley, and then we had Mickey Vago saying, "We beat Devon Dudley," and Luke going, "No, you're an accessory. I beat Devon Dudley." That little silliness, because this is what that match happened, what, 2015 or something like that. So it was just a nice little callback. I'm glad we got Blood Tourist. Well, it wasn't so much Blood Tourist like bloody deathmatch looking sharp, but we got that little that feralness. That I'm going to use that word again in this review, because I've got this portion before I go back to the studio and do the aftermath, where I actually recollect my thoughts and go through my photos. But like the gremlin, I like the gremlin analogy for Luke Sharp, that kind of particular stance in his character. So we got a little bit of he seemed to be just on top form. Luke Sharp is just one of those, again, one of my favourite wrestlers in the country, by far. Not only from his his wrestling standpoint, his character standpoint, from his business acumen in pro wrestling as well. He's just one of those great wrestlers that I super enjoy. I super enjoy him as a wrestler and just as a fan myself. But no, he really dominated quite a lot of the match, which was surprising. Not something you see off a lot from Liu Kang Sharp, but he took many shortcuts, headbutts, scratches, using the hair of Vago to his advantage, by pulling at it and scratching at it and scratching at him. But it was just a really, really good match. Really good match to open up the main portion of the show. Like I say, I was going to say the main card. I talked about in the preview about the importance of the main card, but with the amount of folks that had VIP walk-ups or VIP tickets in general, a lot of people were already in the venue ahead of the time. But no, it was a really, really good match to start off with. We did get to see a cartwheel elbow, if I remember rightly, which was a goddamn shame. But we did get to see a stunner from Mickey Vago out of nowhere, ish, that set up the win for Mickey Vago. It was just a really good match. Just good stuff. I'll probably say that a lot until, again, recollect my thoughts, etc. What was next? I think it was the triple threat. So we've got Zach Dynamite against Tommy Rain and Ollie Green. This was again another. I really like this because I sent in someone when I was watching this. This felt like a Samoa Joe X Division match because you had two guys who are a bit more agile, a bit more high flying in comparison. You had Ollie Green and Tommy Rain, and then you had Zach Dynamite, who is similar in height of his two opponents, but he's a bit broader and was just not interested in this flippy shit. It was just battering whenever he had the chance with his new gauntlets on. He was just swinging kicks and forearms, and I loved that dynamic. We've got just power Zach Dynamite as opposed to the usually he's facing like bigger and taller opponents, so he's got to kind of go to the agility well or the speed well, but in this one he just went for power. It was just demolishing anyone who was getting in front of him, and it was just great. You may see in the montage, hopefully I'll put it in, we've got to see Ollie got a Death Valley driver from Dynamite onto the apron, which looked gnarly. It was just a lot of action back and forth, and then eventually, much to surprise, Ollie Green picked up another win. There was a kill shot from Dynamite onto Tommy Raiden, and then Green bundled Zach Dynamite out of the ring and pinned Raiden to get the win, which again was a shocker. Ollie Green, I think that's it, three wins in a row. First win 2024, and a really solid match for all three guys. I thought Tommy Raiden may have had a bit wobbly in his feet occasionally. Some of Ollie Green's offense was a little bit soft. was a little bit softer. It was more placed than maybe impactful. But I say this to someone who's watching this. Like, I don't know how sore a double foot stomp is, regardless of how much it looks impactful. But it was just I really enjoyed seeing powerhouse Aberdonian ace Zach Dynamite, as opposed to his usual agility high fly, more technical side of him that we've seen before. But no, they're a really good match. Main event of the first half. Oh God, what was that? Main event of the first half was, oh man, wow, I went back. What am I, 33? I went back 20 years with that crack. It was a tag title match. Tag title match was the first half main event. The Outfit versus the Foundation of the Future. I can see there are a lot of big power moves from Bruiser Brad, Ryan, Murphy got involved. I really enjoyed the kind of stuff between Ryan and Ted. That was good little back and forth. A lot of back and forth. This was super even. Even to the point where I was thinking, maybe this could have maybe shaved a couple minutes off, you know? But it was super back and forth.
And a lot of good stuff in the match itself. I'm trying to remember bits and pieces, but there was a couple attempts at Peep Peep special. One definitely hit. I always love the Foundation of the Future's tag team dynamics, where they don't do that. I can't remember an occasion. I'm probably going to be proven wrong really quickly. I can't remember an occasion where they do the you know, when someone does a tag, referee doesn't see it, and then the referee's pushing back the face, the bad guy, Brad will come in and then do that clap, and then the referee turns around and goes, "Oh, he must have tagged in." They don't do that. I still like that they have that respect to the tag team rules, with the rope and the tags, but they're bad bastards at the same time, and they'll take shortcuts where they'll go and trip their opponent off the apron. They'll do all these absolute dickish things, but they still respect the general overarching rules of tag team wrestling. That just makes it so interesting to watch them do a tag team match, and they're one of the best tag teams in the country. That's just a fact. But the outfit kept up. There was a point where I was thinking, oh man, imagine if they've announced that the outfit are going to operate under the Freebird rule with Dino, but what if they lose titles before Dino even gets a chance to step in and defend with the titles? That would have been different. I don't think it would have ever happened before, especially with the Freebird rule. So it would have certainly been an interesting way to go about it. But a lot of like I said, back and forth, a lot of big moves to keep the crowd going. Oh, but eventually, Ted O'Keefe, I think it was Ted O'Keefe, got the pin on, what's it, Ryan. I think it was Ryan, because I made a mental note. It meant that the outfit have pinned both members of the Foundation of the Future in tag title competition. So by my reckoning, by logic here, then that means it puts the Foundation right to the back of the queue. Because if Brad was pinned to lose the titles at Christmas Chaos, and then Ryan was pinned in the rematch, that's both Foundation of the Future members pinned. So they don't have a leg to stand on with saying, oh, we should get a title shot, because no, you've both been pinned in consecutive matches with the titles up for grabs, so you have to go to the back of the queue. Again, totally could be by accident. But I like to think there's some sort of logic in play there. And if they're listening out there, they can pretend that there was, if there wasn't. But I'd like that little dynamic there. It was just a really, really good first half main event. Like I say, probably could have had a couple of minutes shaved off it, perhaps. But, you know, that's really picking holes in something that I still enjoyed watching as a match itself. Interval took place. I got a picture of the outfit. That was what I was doing. Not much happened else in the interval, because I'm trying to think of the awkward thing where I think people recognise me, but I'm not sure. But then I'm not sure if I'm being rude by not saying hello. So I do that weird like head tilt and go, do that quite often. I'm still not sure what to do when I meet people at wrestling shows. I'm just a very awkward human being. That's just life. And it's even worse when people do things like handshakes and high fives. And I really appreciate it, I really do. But I'm very aware that I just go limp and go, spaghetti arms. Do the old Jimbo Bannon Flappy Birds when it comes to that. And it's just super awkward. And I apologise to anyone who has to go through it. Just let me know. Nobody fights more awkward than I do. So after that, we got Captain Allen versus Omar Muhammad. What turned out to be the battle of Omar's shawani. That seemed to be on the line somehow. I will put that in the results. I will make sure it's definitely in the results. The battle for Omar Muhammad's shawani, which Captain Allen kept referring to as a shawani. And he got the line of the night. Captain Allen got the absolute belter of a line in this match, which was after some counters and some wee flashy bits here and there. He just stopped to win. And I'm going to butcher because I've kind of half forgotten the quote. But are you done showing off to your friends now? And I was just like, oh god, Alan, I'm fairly certain you don't like me in life and just hanging about after shows for 10 minutes, 20 minutes. But my God, that was an absolute cracker of a line. And it was just beautiful. It was just in the silence as well. There was a little bit of a silence. And he just went, are you done showing off to your friends now? And it was beautiful. I love Omar's gear now. He's not wearing the tights. He's got this very Bollywood-esque. There will be a name for it, the trousers that he was wearing. But I am uncultured and I have no idea what they're called, but they were simply sensational. I love the look that Omar's going. I love the evolution, the more confidence, the more sensational proportions that he brings into his character, into his gear as well. I love seeing the evolution of Omar, even though I did end up talking about a match that he had at W3L Action Academy that he will not appreciate that I was brought up again. But that was a really long time ago, and to be honest, that match makes me appreciate the Omar Muhammad we've got now, though, because that was him at the start, and to see him, this really confident TV's Omar Muhammad, maybe not for him to revisit, but for me anyway, to see that evolution from a character, from a wrestler who I would have seen, that was the first time I would have seen Omar Muhammad and going, I hate this wrestler. I don't hate him personally, but watching him wrestle was just like, oh, this is awful. And to see him now and go, oh, god damn, this guy is so entertaining. Omar Muhammad is such an entertaining wrestler. It just makes me appreciate it all the more. But no, he and Alan had a really competitive match. Alan, for all his buffoonery, he's a very accomplished, capable wrestler. And people still forget this. That even though he is, by all accounts, an idiot, he is still a really good wrestler. Even shouting about the Shawadi Wadi and all that kind of stuff, and putting on the Shivani, and he's just pure entertainment, and I think he adds extra little bits to each match to make it unique. Because I know for Kelly anyway, she'd seen Grado wrestle, but she's seen Grado wrestle a couple of times on the bounce, and she was like, it's the same match, you know, just about the same match every time, you know what you're going to get. But Captain Allen, he adds something a little bit different to cater to his opponent, to make it a little bit stupider, but in the most perfectly entertaining way. That's the skill of Captain Allen. I think it's made I think it helps as well that Captain Allen is, you only see him wrestle zone. So it's all contained in the Northeast, you know, getting it put online and going all over the place and what have you. But it's just a nice little comic relief on a show that Captain Allen always provides. It's just a really entertaining wrestler. Like I said, I don't think he particularly appreciates myself, but I don't care. As long as he keeps entertaining everyone, including myself, Captain Allen can do no wrong in my eyes in that respect. What was the finish to that? Was it the double knees from... Oh, there is a name for the move. I'm so sorry, Omar, but it's 10, it's like 5 to 11. I'm not remembering things all the way. It was probably something cars related. It was double knees to the corner, I think, was the finish. And Omar picked up the win. I could be wrong. I'm so sorry if I'm wrong, but I'm operating on my bladder being full and concentrating on the road. I'm just past Keith. Hopefully, WrestleZone, get to Keith. I want to take my son to your shows. You are popping his wrestling cherry. Come to Keith. I guess the closest you guys will come to where I can conceivably take him to a show and not feel super guilty about getting him home so late, because he's only 18 months old. So after that was Evan Young versus Chris Archer. Had a little bit of speaking back and forth near the start. Archer being a little... Oh, I've totally missed a bit. I'll get back to Archer and Evan Young. After the first half main event, so after the outfit won, then they went back. Zach Dynamite came out, got the microphone. Now, because the venue having a high ceiling, I didn't really catch a lot, but the general gist of it saw William Sterling come out, and it was kind of given away that Zag Dynamite, you know, told everyone that William's not only a wrestler, he's actually part of WrestleZone management, and they eventually goaded William Sterling. There's a lot of spitting on this show. That saw Dynamite spit into the face. We saw Luke Sharp spit as well. We saw Ronan King spit later. There's a lot of spitting on the show. But they goaded William Sterling into the ring, beat him down, put that chair around his knee, and then Damien came out to make the save and chased off the foundation. And what is fascinating to me about this is I think we're getting teased for Abaddon Anarchy already. And I have a super big, this is why I've interrupted Evan Young versus Chris Archer, because I have a theory that I want to put out there right now in this episode. Even though you can't see my face, you're probably only seeing some writing, I might say visit swnscotland.com. I don't know, I might say that. But I have a theory, and I think we're going to see some net right. So, William Sterling was WrestleZone attacked at Christmas Chaos by the Foundation, and it was goaded by talking about Scotty Swift. William Sterling goaded into an attack from Foundation of the Future, saved by Damien. Damien will probably get attacked, I think probably Ring of Rumble, I would say, if I was going to be a betting man here. I think there should be an attack, and there should be an attack in Pierhead. And I think, now this could be a wild, wild theory here, I think it should be Brian Tucker. Now, again, wild, but I think Foundation of the Future are now attacking the foundations of WrestleZone, and that would be your William Sterling, your Damien, your Scotty Swift, using Scotty Swift's name to facilitate an attack. And if they take out someone like Brian Tucker, shows their intentions not black and white. It's they're taking out the foundations of WrestleZone. Whether that means, and I don't think that means that Tucker would necessarily turn face, but I think it would necessitate Tucker to agree to renege on the stipulations from Christmas Chaos 2022, which would bring Scotty Swift back into WrestleZone. Then we would get at Abaddon Anarchy, we would get the Foundation of the Future versus Damien, Scotty Swift, and William Sterling. And I think that would possibly be finally William Sterling's farewell, because you get a team with Scotty Swift, the Granite City Horror Podcast team. I think that would be a really nice kind of bow at the end of William Sterling's WrestleZone career. So that was my wild theory. I think Brian Tucker possibly needs to watch his back, because I think that would be a very great story plot point if we got that in there. Another thing I've forgotten is Tommy Raiden came out with a shacket and drumsticks in his match, and Mickey Vago sent him off like a proud dad, which was a nice little like evolution to that. I would have liked to see him be a little bit more like that boy did with Judas at Christmas Chaos. I would have liked him to be a little bit more sneaky, maybe use those drumsticks, those triple threat, no DQ. Anyway, moving on. Evan Young versus Chris Archer. Again, the epitome of this was just a very even contest. And I think for the position that Chris Archer seems to be in right now, he's kind of in that middle ground, nothing really happening. Chris Archer, I would have maybe seen this could have been Evan Young comes in and gets a really quick win. But that being said, you're always going to get a solid match out of Chris Archer. It's a guarantee. That's just the what you get with Chris Archer. And I think putting him in with Evan Young was a nice, a good opportunity for Evan Young to shake off some ring rust and put on a solid match. It also means that they're kind of like Archer's short, but so is Evan. Evan's just a little bit shorter, so it made Evan look bigger. By facing Chris Archer, Chris Archer's only a little bit bigger than Evan Young, so perspective wise it made Evan Young look bigger physically as well. So that was just again, you can totally read into things, I don't know. So that was a roll up win from Evan Young out of nowhere. That was a nice little shock, which got the crowd going, ooh. So that was good. I've heard that sound this bit. I don't know. May have done. So that led us into the main event, which was Skull Brawl versus Flippy and Drippy. And despite me disliking the name Flippy and Drippy, and if I've learned anything from Ronan King in our many chats, either the podcast or catching up with shows, I think the irritation of the name Flippy and Drippy makes it all the more fun, because it's just Drippy. I understand why it's Flippy and Drippy. One does flips, usually Connor. Ronan does flips as well. And the drip, you know, but Drippy just makes one of them sound really wet, and that's just, and it's usually a bad thing to be called a drip. But I think that they just, everything that Ronan does, and I think he carries it with such confidence that his stuff, like his merch, Arm the Anarchy, and his Flippy and Drippy, and wearing his mum's coats and stuff like that, because he carries it with such confidence, it works, whereas otherwise it should never work. It should be lame, it should be stupid, it should be like the worst thing ever, but because he carries it with so much confidence and believability in himself, it makes it work, which is just kudos to Ronan. He is a fantastic wrestler. He is a complete package, and it's an absolute disgrace that he's only 20. Because he is the complete package of the wrestler already, and he's probably, that's why he's my early pick for Regal Rumble this year. He's my early pick for Regal Rumble this year. And I at the moment I can't see anyone else with him. I know Kelly is going to be furious, which doesn't listen to this podcast anyway, so I picked Caleb to win two in a row. But I think we're going to get Ronan Aspen at Arm the Anarchy, and it's going to hurt me to say this, but I think Ronan would win. And I think that's maybe a shocking thing to say, but I would want Aspen to win, but I wouldn't begrudge Ronan with it either. I'd be sad about it, you know, because I'd obviously Aspen lose. But these guys came out Flippy and Drippy, matching pink camo gear. Connor plays sleazy so well, like ridiculously well. He was just absolute sleaze, grinding in, like he could eat himself, that kind of absolute, you know. I think he was the drippy one. But they came out matching camo. I liked it was pink. Again, don't know if that was on purpose, but Aspen's pretty well known for wearing pink and black, and they were wearing pink camo. I don't know if it's a wee mind game thing. I love that they came out in matching gear though. That just legitimizes them as a tag team straight away. Everything about Flippy and Drippy, like I said, I don't like the name, but I understand why it does the job. It makes me dislike it even more. It makes me dislike the team because they've got such a crap name, but the crap name makes me dislike them, so it's worked in that respect. I'm cross-eyed, but it was just, I love this, I just love them as a team. They're great, they're great in this match. And we've got Skull Brawl come out, they're still Aspen and Caleb, and they came out in their usual gear. But maybe I don't know if we're going to see that evolution. Maybe we're going to see, because Magic Caleb came out in some pink and black gear as well, like some sort of Heart Foundation kind of get up. Oh man, I can see Caleb being the Night Heart. I can absolutely see. Oh man, now that's popped into my brain now, and I can't unsee it. We're going to see Jim the Anvil, Caleb the Anvil Valhalla. I'm all in. My brain's, that's it. My brain shut off. It's Fritz, because I just thought of Caleb the Anvil Valhalla getting pink and black on for another match down the line. But this was a war. I think this is probably the most I've taken videos of a match, because there was always a highlight. They built it. This match has so many peaks and troughs. So they built it up to a big move, and then a little bit of brawling, and then big move, a little bit of brawling, big move, and the crowd always rose to the big move. And there was a lot of suicide dives, there was a lot of lots of high impact moves, and a lot of false finishes. Again, possibly could have taken a couple of them out, but that would be very picky, because I just couldn't stop watching this match, because it was fantastic. And I think it worked well, because you had Ronan and Connor, who were looking to get a scalp off Skull Brawl, but they were being super confident about it, overconfident at times. And then you had Caleb, who was always trying to make sure that Sorcerer Aspen was okay as well. He was always checking on Sorcerer Aspen. And then you had Aspen just be like, oh, these guys are getting on my absolute tits, I'm just going to absolutely murder them. And he did that several times, including a gnarly, use that word again, that gnarly powerbomb onto Connor, onto Caleb's knees. And it was, oh, the sound that Connor made was guttural, and you could feel the pain from that. But you know, there's so many highlights in this match. Go, if you haven't, if you skip the montage, go check the montage, because I got so many little clips of this particular match, because there were so many fun things that happened in it. Possibly one of my favourite matches of the year 2024, and I've not seen that much wrestling yet. But it's probably one of my favourite matches so far this year. It's certainly going to go into the poll, monthly poll, at the very least. So a lot of good stuff in that match. And Ronan and Connor won. They pinned. There was a little thing where they kissed. They both kissed Ronan. Ronan and Caleb, Connor kissed the cheeks of Aspen's face, and then did a super kick to the head, slightly inside the head. They called it the Kiss of Death, I think they called it. Great, they've already got tag team moves, tag team names. So they've put a hell of a lot of work into that team already, and it's all the early days. We see Flippy and Drippy do more. But yeah, there's so much happening. But Caleb got pinned in the end, and we got to see Flippy and Drippy win, and I think that pleads my case. We possibly will see Ronan win the Rumble, and you know, call it a wild shot, but he's definitely number one in my fave five right now to win the match. Connor's probably thrown in there as well. He, like I say, he's very sleazy, made it look like he can eat himself, that kind of way. But he's got this kind of feralness about him now, where he's kind of just like losing to Aspen and Christmas Chaos broke him mentally, and it's caused him to be this feral little monster, which is beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Just great, great team, great match, and we've got to see. I think is this possibly the first time we've seen Aspen lose since he's won the title at Christmas Chaos 2022? I think so. I can't remember. He possibly may have lost a tag match somewhere, but I can't remember. But he's still not been pinned. But I think it's possibly one of the first times he's lost, which is very interesting. I'm going to go to the shop. I think I'm going to pick up some coffee sweets for my little throat. So, a fantastic night. I really enjoyed it. I'm going to try going to Pierhead on 24th of February. Can't guarantee that I'll be going, but we're certainly going to make the best attempt to go. But if not, it'll be Regal Rumble that will be next. But I've been kicking off the calendar strong for WrestleZone. Really good kickoff to the year. Like I say, for the venue itself, for a change arena, hopefully we see the crowd get bigger for that show, for that venue, and we get to see the partition move back further, and we get to see that be an RBRK arena, possibly with a big name, with big guests. There was something a little bit unsettling though with Lee McAllister, you know, boxer, just kind of stalking around, making sure everything was okay. It was wide-eyed, terrifying. There was that going on, which I always kind of kept at the back of my mind going, oh God, it's a little bit scary, you know, Celium Caster and stalking around the venue. But no, it's a really great show. I'll have more thoughts when I've recovered and looked through my photos and videos, but I'll be in the studio and you'll actually see me. You see me a little bit now because of street lights, people. Yeah, really great car. I'm glad I'm spoken about it because I've got this little cough and I'm like, oh, it was a really good show, but you know, I'm a bit dour because I've got sore throats and being all. But now I've actually spoken through the match and the show and the card itself. It was a fantastic night of wrestling that I really enjoyed. You know, things weren't always clean in the matches itself. There was like stumbles here and there in matches. I say some may have had a couple minutes shaved off it, wouldn't have hurt it. But as far as an entertainment spectacle and making it worth my while driving an hour and a half, hour and 40 to get to the show and having to go through Old Belgium twice, it was absolutely worth going once again. So this is it. I'm going to turn it to Asda now, not physically. If they're open, actually. If they're not, then this is a very awkward way to end a podcast. Are they open? Let's find out. We're going to find out together. Because that's just what we do on the SWN podcast. We go through a journey together. I mean, the big ASA sign is off. So that is not a good sign.
A few moments later.
Anyway. Ah, someone's got shopping, so it must be open. Anyway, you don't need to see this. But thank you for watching. I'll be back in the studio in a moment. So I'll see you then.
And that's us back in the studio. Hello, people. I am got a sore throat, as I always seem to do after a WrestleZone show. My body doesn't like to stand outside for too long, it seems. So I've recorded the WrestleZone recap. It'll be out already. I'm going to try and write up something this week as well about the show. But in general, I don't have a lot more to add, seeing as I rambled for 40 minutes on the way home, on the recording, certainly, as you took my journey from the turn-off from Old Belgium to back to Elgin, and the whole journey, all the way to me going to Asda. I even took out a little bit where I just went dead silent while I was trying to park up and find a space in the car park. So you got pretty much a lot of my thoughts on the show. It was a really, really good show, really great show. And it was one of those ones where at the time, because I was feeling a little bit wabbit and that, I was just like, I really enjoyed that, but was it as good as I thought it was? And then when I was speaking about it on the way home to the camera, which I have in the edit, I've like just ramped up the brightness as much as I can, so you can see me a little bit in the background. So again, I apologize for that, for a lot of darkness in that particular section of the podcast. But the montage came out quite well, so, you know, got to balance it out here. But no, speaking about the show, I realised how hyped I was for it, how much I enjoyed it, and it just to the point where I'm going, right, go to Peterhead, February 24th, and they've got Regal Rumble, and then that'll probably be until after the Anarchy. I'll probably skip April, unless it's Keith. If it's Keith, I'm coming. Jack's going to his first wrestling show, and it's going to be WrestleZone and Keith. That is the agreement. That is where he's going. That is his first event for WrestleZone. Because close enough if he kicks off and goes. But I don't have any more additional thoughts. But only one that came to mind while I was in the shower. As you do, I was thinking about the show. And what other bits I could jump in and think of. Was the interesting dynamic of the attack that William Sterling got from Foundation of the Future. So Sterling got attacked, he was down, he got saved by Damien. And then the next match on the show was Captain Allen coming out, which of course is William Sterling's brother. So he came out, they arsed about it, they're not bothered about William being attacked, assaulted by the team of the Foundation of the Future. So that was a funny little marker moment for myself to think about afterwards and notice. And the only other thing I think of is I mentioned the recap edition, which unfortunately I probably have to just to chop the hell out of it because of coughing. At one point I sneeze, So if you can find out when I sneezed, hopefully I will have edited it out by then. And I've cut it out. I'll use the match graphics, throw them in to try and curtail it out of that, or have to re-record again. I don't want to do that. I can absolutely avoid it. The other thing, I'll hear a line from Dennis Law about the thoughts of the possible low blow. You will have seen in the montage from William Sterling to Rhys Dawkins. Dawkins jumping from the second rope, the most dangerous rope, and ended up split legging over the shin of William Sterling. So I want to get a line from senior referee Dennis Law to find out what his thoughts are, if it was unintentional, and just where we go from there. That's just, you're getting that cough for free. But no, it was a really great night from WrestleZone. I'm looking forward to go back. Say, hopefully Peterhead is the plan, but certainly not. Definitely Regal Rumble time on March 30th. A great start to the year, and hope to get to many shows this year for WrestleZone, as I aim to get to my 100th show ever. Because I think I'm sitting on like 92 now or something like that. So it certainly could happen this year, barring any problems. I should be able to possibly hit 100 shows this year, which I'm really excited for, because I like going to the wrestling, and hopefully I'll take another few companies off this year that I haven't been to before, and if not, certainly get some more footage and see some more wrestling, because my whole thing this year seems to be imploring companies to put out stuff online, whether it's through a Patreon, like Fair City have done, like North Wrestling I've done recently as well. Either that or just put out stuff online, subscription services on YouTube, Vimeo. I don't know the logistics entirely, but I want to see more promotions put out online content this year, because not everyone could go to all these events all over the country, but they would be willing to pay a sum to watch them. I'm not saying they have to be live, I'm not saying they have to be on the day of or the day after, but I think that there's a monetary opportunity there for promotions to do more online content for people to check out. There's always going to be risks of people pirating it, of course, but that's hopefully would outweigh the rewards would be to get the product out there, hopefully pushing ticket sales, etc., in the near future. So it's an exciting year possibly coming up. My throat is just absolutely dead. I'm trying to find the mute button. There it is.
A few moments later.
I might throw in the one a few moments later again. My eyes are watering from that cough. So I'm going to go and just go and recover, because I've still got the rewards, the 2023 year-end awards bit to record, which possibly will be this afternoon, I think. I think I'll need a little bit more recovery time, because, you know, it's just a bloody January. I'm always ill in January. Also, it'd be all December as well, it's one of those things. But anyway, hope you've enjoyed the season so far. This is the official penultimate episode of the season, the 8th road trip on our road trip, our on tour season of the SWN podcast. I hope you've enjoyed what we've done this year. Like I say, it hasn't been as road trip heavy as I was anticipating. I thought I was only going to do. I always say I'm going to do fortnightly episodes. Always the intention for these podcasts, and end up doing weekly, and end up doing two a week, and always ends up spreading out of control. So I hope you've enjoyed this season. Next episode will be the 2023 year end awards, and then we've got an encore coming up and an epilogue. I think it's the other way around: an epilogue, then an encore, which will just be like auxiliary episodes, just out with season six. They're just kind of like the celebration episodes of the past seasons. That's the kind of thought process there, even though it's with a fresh guest in Frank Gallo and a returning guest in Mickey Vago. So looking forward to getting them recorded this week, and just keep an eye on social media. Thank you very much for supporting us. The YouTube numbers haven't been as great this year, and I think it's due to the changes in Twitter, because a lot of our traffic for the YouTube used to go through Twitter. Now they changed the way how links work and what they'll show and what they'll push and what have you. But our audio numbers have been fantastic this year, so I'm glad that people are at least listening to the show in high numbers, if you're not wanting to look at my face every so often. But again, I'm going to leave this season as it is, because it's leave this episode as it is, because it's going to be like an hour and a half long. Hope you enjoyed the montages. We'll keep doing them. And keep an eye on our social media and our website, swnscotland.com. Thank you for supporting SWN. And we'll see you next time. Have a good one.